selection or to have talk is other than do Kamasutra, which means similarly. I think everybody has their own personal copy. That would be very helpful for you to follow my explanation. I have selected these sutras. Tomorrow I will go on many the sutra. On the 18th, I go on Sarvabhasa Sutra. On the 19th, I go on Anuruddha Sutra. And 20th, on Dakshina Vibhaga Sutra. These are the selected sutras that I'm going to focus my discussion. Today, Allah got to come a sutra. And you can read it yourself and study at hand. So, once the Buddha was living in Jetha's grove, Anatha Pindika's monastery, there was a monk called Aritha. Aritha formerly was Vajra Kila. He comes from Vajra Kila's tradition. And he had this pernicious view. What is that pernicious view? As I understand the Dharma taught by the Blessed One, those things called obstruction by the Blessed One, are not able to obstruct one who engages in them. This is a real challenge to Buddha. So there were some monks who were so brave that they challenged the Buddha and said this statement. He not only believed in that, but he expressed this view in public. And what are the objections? There are objections such as kammavarana, vipakavarana, dittavarana, like these obstructions, that is, some kammas, if they have committed certain kammas like killing mother, killing father, killing another, wounding the Buddha with malicious intention and creating schism among the Sangha, so forth. These are very serious, heavy kammas. And also killing anybody, stealing and so forth, sensual misconduct, these are unwholesome things. If you commit these things, it will be impossible for you to attain liberation in that life, or even in many lives in the future. And these are obstacles, obstructions. Buddha has mentioned certain obstructions later in the discourse. When he made this statement in public, the monks heard this and said to him, several bhikkhus having heard about this, went to the bhikkhu Aditya and asked the family Aditya, it is not that such a pernicious view has arisen in you. Exactly so, friend. As I understand, so it is repeated this view. And then this because deciding his well-being out of compassion, since they were men, he was a member of the community of Sangha. Sangha has a certain responsibility to advise him as friends. But he did not listen. Now this is a very wonderful thing among the Sangha. They like everybody to follow the Buddha's teaching very sincerely, understand the teaching and follow the teaching, so that they all can attain enlightenment. And then even again, getting rid of their suffering, and therefore they are duty, responsibility to advise this man, Parikha, not to have this pernicious view. They could not persuade him to give it up. Then finally, out of compassion for him again, the monk went to the Buddha. And he advised him several times. And he said, Blessed One would not speak thus. For in many ways the Blessed One has stated how obstructive things are, obstructions. How they are able to obstruct one who engages in them. Then they gave one example of obstruction. This example is, the Blessed One has stated the sensual pleasures provide little gratification. This is one example, sensual pleasures. And as I mentioned earlier, this is one of the things that obstruct. Not all, this is one. So mention, sensual pleasure has little gratification. Much suffering and despair, and the danger in them is still more. This is particularly true with regard to monastic life. This doesn't mean that lay people should not live lay life as they normally live. And yet, even they must understand that indulgence in sensual pleasure is not conducive to the attainment of liberation. Even though they engage in sensual pleasures, they too eventually have to give it up in order to attain liberation. But they have certain excuses as lay people. But here, this particular monk, Aritya, without any discrimination, without any qualification, he made this sweeping statement. And that is why this monk wanted to persuade him not to have that view. Then, if sensual pleasure definitely, slave Israel is the cause of suffering. That is the second noble truth. So there is no way that you can get away with that. So they gave the similes that Buddha has given to illustrate the difficulty, the problem with the sensual pleasure. One simile is with the simile of the skeleton. It is supposed if the word skeleton is used only for a bone, suppose there is a dog very hungry and roaming around looking for food, stopped by the butcher shop. The butcher after scraping all the flesh from a horn, just blood smeared horn, he throws at the dog. Then the dog keeps licking it, licking it, licking, 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 licking. More he licks, more he gets tired, and yet he cannot give up because there is a little bit of taste. Eventually his tongue also begins to bleed. By licking, his tongue begins to bleed. And that blood also tastes good to him, so he needs more. He never stops. Eventually, he will hurt himself, perhaps even he will injure himself, and will even die. This is one example. With a similar piece of meat, that is, suppose you throw a piece of meat and a bird comes and picks it up. And as it flies, other birds also come back on it to grab that piece of meat. Because they all like meat. Then, with a similar to grass torch, in a grass torch, you go against the wind. Wind is blowing towards you. You hold the torch, burn, and go against it. And then that flame comes and burns your clothes, hands, and so on. It's simply a bit of coal. Assume that there is a bit of coal with no flame, but amber is there, the heat is there, very hot, and if you fall in it, you will be in pretty danger. Similarly, on the green, this very common simile, in green you do all sorts of things in the world. The best thing you want to do, you do in dreams. When you get up, there's nothing. It is just empty dream. People try to interpret dreams, that is just waste of time. There seems to be a borrowed goods. This is supposed to borrow a very expensive suit to attend somebody's wedding, and you mingle with people showing off that very expensive suit. The man who loaned it to you comes behind you and tap on your shoulder and say, "Mister, I have to loan it to so and so tomorrow. You return the soul." How embarrassing it is to you. And yet And to lose it, you think you say that that gives you status. You feel very proud. That is the sense of pleasure, temporarily. Then, with the symmetry of fruits on a tree. Tree is full of fruit. You climb it and you keep eating. Then there is another man who comes and he cannot climb. But he also wants to eat the fruits. What does he do? He takes an axe and cut down the tree. If you do not get down from the tree very quickly, you will fall down with the tree and die. Similarly, someone indulges in sensual pleasures, does not give it up, the person goes on in samsara, on and on and on in madhura. Then, with the image of Buddha's knife and law, Buddha's knife, it is eating honey in a very sharp razor. You have to be very careful. You can cut to a tongue. If you are not careful, then you eat honey with a very sharp razor, long razor. So this has to be done like that way. The with the symbol of sword stay is the same as the previous one. With the symbol of snake's head. Snake head is the symbol of this name of this discourse. We will explain it later. The snake has a poison in his pouch in the tongue. Then, using these similes, Buddha has explained the danger of sensual pleasure, danger of indulging in sensual pleasure, and these several items. It's okay, don't worry. It doesn't obstruct you. And that is why this monk tried to persuade him to give it up. Although they could not they tried using all these similes and questioning and cross-questioning, but they could seem to say that therefore Arita would not give it up, and then finally, this is not just backbiting or slandering, but they, out of compassion for him, they went and reported it to the Buddha. That's why I said, then they said, since you could not detect the Vipu-Arita form of your watcher, from this precious view, we have reported this matter to the present man. Then the Buddha called him and asked Arita to come to him, and he said, he came. And this Bhikkhu said that asked him to come to see the Buddha. Then Buddha also reprimanded him, saying, misguided man, more the person. To whom have I ever known me to teach the Dhamma in this way? Do you know whether I taught this Dhamma in this way to bhikkhus or bhikkhunis, upasakas, upasika? He's greater than hell, I am not greater than death. How obstinate you things are, obstructions, and how they are able to obstruct those who are trying to follow them. And he gave the same series and gives the truth. Then, Buddha addressed the Guru now. Buddha knew Aditya is so adamant, so stubborn, he would not give up. Sometimes Buddha, when he found someone having either committed something wrong or has some wrong view, he advises the person, and then the person gives it up and follows the Dharma and continues the Dharma in the correct way. But this Aditya is incorrigible. He cannot correct, cannot be corrected. Then Buddha made him feel that he is not a member of the community. So when Buddha gave this advice, Aditya saw that he was looking down and became very silent, quiet, and didn't have to say anything. Then Aditya, formerly the Rajagiravacha, sat silent, dismayed, with shoulders rooted and head down, glum, and without response. Seeing this, Buddha continued his teaching. Now, we come to the next section. Okay, Buddha asked the monks, do you also believe? They said, no. Then Buddha said, for immigrants, these monks also confirmed the Buddha's statements, and Buddha said, yes, good. It is good that you understand the Dharma taught by me thus, for in many ways I have stated how obstructions are obstructions, and so forth, he repeated the same thing, same series. Then, someone learns the Dharma like catching a snake. What is the Dharma he learns? He learns Sutta, Gaya, Vedyakarana, Gatha, Udana, Ityutta. Amuta, Dharma, Vedyakarana, and so forth. There are nine limbs of the teaching. It's called Navanga Sattusaha. Navanga Sattusaha, nine aspects of the teachings of the Buddha. Number one is discourses. Two stanzas. Discourses mean the suttas. Sutta means is a very complete essay. There's an introduction, the body, and conclusion. Then essay is completed with these three components. It is called Sutta. Introduction, and then the body, and conclusion. Then stanzas, composed in certain meters, like Dhammapada, Sutta Nipata, and so forth. Then exposition, like meters and various discourses, actually. Then verses to be resulted. Then actually the explanation is Abhutadhamma was. And then sayings, short saying, then verse stories for Jataka, and Marcus answers to questions and questions. Therefore, read that there are two discourses in Madhyamakaya, Chola Vedala Mahavedala, and Samadhi Sutta, and so on. There are discourses. Then, having learned the Dhamma the correct way, then do not, having learned the Dhamma in this way, I mean this nine years of Dhamma, then do not examine the meaning of those teaching with wisdom. Now, okay, not examining the meaning of those teaching with wisdom, they do not gain reflective acceptance of them. Now, this is the purpose of learning Dhamma. We have to learn it, remember it, and examine the meaning very carefully. If we remember and do not examine, and do not understand, when you don't understand, how can you examine the meaning in order to get it more clarified? You have to ask a question. If you don't know that, you don't understand that quite well. Then, instead they learn the Dhamma only for the sake of criticizing others and for being in debate. Out of pride and ignorance. Pride is to question, criticize others. And then ignorance is just to make others believe that you know things, and you want to keep talking and talking and talking without coming to an end, and you want to be new there. That is because of ignorance. And they do not experience the good for the sake of which they learn the Dhamma. Why we learn the Dhamma? We want to put the Dhamma into the first thing that one can understand and put them into practice so that we can liberate ourselves from samsara to suffering. And then Buddha came to the main theme of this discourse. The title of this discourse is the snake simile, the simile of the snake. Suppose a man needing a snake, seeking a snake, wandering in search of a snake, saw a large snake and grasped it, its coil or its tail. It would turn back on him and bite his hand or his arm, or one of his limbs, and because of that he would come to death or deadly suffering. Why is that? Because of the strong grasp of the snake. That is very, very important message. Friends, if a snake bites, when you handle the snake incorrectly, in the first place, why don't catch a poisonous snake? You want to extract poison and use it meditate. Poisonous snake, poison, it's used for medicine even in the Buddha's time. I think that is common even today. And knowing that the snake is poisonous, you want to get it, but you don't know how to get it. You hold him by his tail or coil or some part, and he turns around and stings you, bites you, and injects enormous amount of poison into the body. Similarly, when a snake bites you and injects poison into your body, you will die or you will have serious sickness. That is in this life, one life. But misunderstanding that is much more dangerous than a snake bite. A snake bite can kill you in this life. Misunderstanding Dhamma can poison not only you. When you are poisoned by misunderstanding or you have misunderstood the Dhamma, you can poison millions of other people, giving this wrong message. And you suffer not only in this life, because of that, you suffer in many, many lives in the future. Death, and after death, or life after life and life, you will suffer. That is the danger. That is why the Buddha used this particular simile to illustrate the danger of misunderstanding of Dhamma. Because there is a wrong grasp here, Buddha explains Dhamma. In a correct way. Somebody with their ignorance and pride misunderstand and pretend to be knowledgeable of Dhamma and teaches others. Many people do that. Especially these days, since there are so many resources, media, social media, books, e-books, audio books, paper books, and so forth and so on, and lectures online. Online has some good service as well. But when you read some of them, you can feel confused. You don't know what to believe, what to accept. That goes with your meditation. And if that is different than here, but I don't want to touch on that right now. They do not learn Dhamma for the sake of criticizing others. Here, a person who learns Dhamma is learning not for that. And they experience good for the sake of which they have learned the Dhamma. Those teaching being rightly learned by them, conduce to their own well-being, happiness for long time. Why is that? Because they have to grab the Dhamma correctly. And put together way to capture snake. He said, suppose a man living in a snake, seeking a snake, wandering in search of a snake, saw a today if we can place the snake's head down and the snake cannot move, then you get it. Similarly, using your wisdom, you learn Dhamma, because that this Dhamma is for the wise, not for the unwise. Using your wisdom, you learn the Dhamma, and then use that Dhamma so that you can use it correctly. Okay. Then, if you really analyze the meaning of my statement given by an accordingly, and when you do not understand the meaning of the of my statement, then ask either me about it or those bhikkhus who are wise. Now, in the Buddha's time, there were many wise arhats, like Sariputta, Mantaniputta, Kachana, and so forth, Virupa Ananda, Virupa Mokala, so forth. They are wise, enlightened people. Buddha said, when you learn something, if you don't understand it correctly, if you have a doubt, ask me, the Buddha, or one of these elderly monks. Then he gave another simile in this discourse, one for the simile he gave. That simile also is very important. Simile of rat. Being for the purpose of crossing over, not for the purpose of rafting. Raft is used to cross the body of water. Listen and attend closely to what I should say. Because, of course, we can read this. Suppose you are traveling to go somewhere, and you know in your way there are lot of dangers. Wild animals, poisonous snakes, thieves, and so on your way. And you run for your life. And you run and run and run, you come across a body of water. Maybe a river. But there is no boat, nor a bridge to cross the river, and behind you others may be following you, and you want to save your life. If you cross the body of water, go to the other shore, you feel you will be secure and safe. So you look around and find some twigs, ropes, branches, and so forth. You put them together, make sort of makeshift boat, raft, temporary. It is strong enough for you to jump on it. And using your hands and legs, you cross the body of water. Now when you cross the river, when you get onto the raft, you just don't keep floating. It's good to float. It is not enough. You have to sink, you have to use your hands and legs to cross the body of water. Atma is the breath. You have to hold it. That means you have to make it. You remember? Just like holding the bone, you have to remember and make effort. By using as you use the breath to cross the body over. Similarly, when you remember the Dhamma, you have to make effort to use the Dhamma. Remembering Dhamma itself is not enough. Investigating the meaning is not enough. You have to put it into practice. In order to put it into practice, you have to make effort. If you simply hold on to it very tightly, you cannot cross the body of water. And once you cross the body of water using the rat, Buddha asked this monk, what should the person do after crossing the body of water? Since the rat was very helpful, the person must be very grateful to this rat because it saved his life from these dangers. What should he do? Should he carry it on his shoulders, saying that this craft is useful to me, I'm grateful to it? Or should he leave it on the shore or float it in the water? If he is a sensible person, he would leave the raft on the shore, so that somebody else can use it, or float it in the water. Similarly, even though Dhamma is so wonderful, that helps us to cross the samsara organ. There are four organs: karma organ, bhava organ, vidya organ, avidya organ. Karma organ means the flood of desire, flood of sensual pressure, flood of greed. It's a very big flood. We have to cross this flood. Bhava means becoming. Becoming means thought arising in our mind. Becoming simply means thought keeps arising in our mind again and again and again and again. And this thought becomes solidified, eventually become karma, and make us take rebirth again. That is upapatti bhava. Karma bhava is the thought arising in our mind. Upapatti bhava means taking birth according to these karmas that we have accumulated in our mind. That is another over, another life. Bhava, ditto means views, beliefs, all kinds of beliefs. 62 of them are mentioned in Brahma Jnana Sutra Dignika, 62 views. That is an ocean of views. We have to cross that. Then the most dangerous of all of them is avidyoga, flood of ignorance. Flood of ignorance. So, Dhamma we use to cross these four types of floods. Karma, bhava, ditto, avidyoga. Not to cling to it. That is important thing. And the Buddha said, yo deta mara panyaya jena jitantara ke anivesana sya. Using the wisdom weapon, Mara. Living Mara. After defeating Mara, what you gain, you should not set it on that. What you gain should not be made your home. Let it go. If you hold on to what you gain, you have not won. You are still in samsara, in the trap of Mara. So this rat simile is the meaning of rat simile is deeper than the meaning of snake simile. Because it addresses the craving. First one addresses ignorance. Snake simile addresses ignorance. That is why you don't know how to hold a snake, because of ignorance. Second simile addresses craving. These are the two developments, tanha, avidya. Avidya is first one, craving, catching the snake. Second one is craving. Because of craving, you hold tanha vacca. Depending on craving, we cling. So, therefore, Buddha said, use the Dhamma to cross the body of water. And he finally made a very famous statement. Dhamma to be paid pahatabha bhagyava adhamma. Even the good Dhamma you should let go. Give up, let alone wrong dharma, path dharma. Even the good dharma that helps you to get rid of your suffering should be given up. Don't hold on to it. You know, when you hold on to dharma, you become religious fanatic. You become religious and religious freaks. It is these religious fanatics who causes war. Remember in history, in religious history, so many war. Who caused this war? The religious fanatics. Because they hold on to it very tightly, tenaciously. They do not give up. They don't use the religion as a raft. And they not serve the Dhamma, they disserve the Dhamma. Not that they don't use it, but they abuse it. Because they don't hold on to it. See, Buddha is so intelligent, wise. He said, use it, but don't hold on to it. There's a very wonderful message you get from this discourse. And then, okay. Now, because when you know the Dhamma to be similar to the raft, you should abandon even the teachings. How most of things contrary to the teaching. It is contrary to the teaching. Because there are these six standpoints of views. What are the six? Here we go an untaught ordinary person who has not regard for the noble ones and is unskilled in undisciplined in the Israel not regard for true men and is unskilled and undisciplined in their government. Regard material form thus. Now here, this word, a true man, I disagree with that word. It should be a person with integrity. That here, the true man is not quite palatable. Who has no regard for person with integrity? And answer them and administrate in their government, figure material form thus. Now, all these both give both problems, ignorance and greed arise from this. What are they? There is a material form thus. This is mine, this I am, this is myself. When you say this is mine, what comes to your mind? And this is mine, this is mine, this is mine, this is mine. What does it come to mind? Desire. Right? Desire. This is mine. Tanha. This I am. What does come to your mind? Man. Conceit. Then this I am, this is myself. What does come to your mind? View, deity. So these three things, tanha, impari, it is even better. Tanha, mana, deity. This is my tanha. This I am mana. This is myself, deity. View. One who is called this is mine, this I am, this is myself. Material form. We call material form. This is mine. This body is mine. I think this body is mine. This is not mine. This belongs to my mother. You know, father's contribution is only one spur. That's all. Then for 9 months, mother wrote us up inside. Every cell after that is produced by the mother. Just imagine when she eats, she has to eat for two. When she drinks, she has to drink for two. When she thinks, she has to think for two. Think of a baby. Everything she does for two. And this body doesn't belong to us. Although we claim to be owner of the body, we are not owner of the body. Literally, biologically, scientifically, it is true. And Buddha said, this is not mine. You just ask this question, you are learning biology? You have learned biology? Ask yourself, does this body belong to me? No. Honestly, no. he belonged to the mother. And foolishly he changed his mind. And this body, I am this body. How can this body be I am? It is not I am. Why not? If I am, I should be able to control it in not the way I like. Can you control it? I don't want to grow old. I honestly don't want to grow old. But can I stop it? No. I don't want to fall sick. I take insurance, life insurance, medical insurance, and still I cannot stop falling sick. Therefore, the basis of I am. And above all, this is myself. This is not myself. Even in myself, the self should be able to have some ownership of this body. It's not ever. Similarly, Buddha was addressing the bhikkhus and pointed out that body, feelings, perception, volition, consciousness, these five aggregates are not I, not mine, not myself. Why? Because they put their own things, regardless whatever we think, they don't care. The body does its own thing, feeling does its own thing, perception does its own thing, volition does its own thing, consciousness does its own thing, doesn't do it all. Why? Every fraction of the second they change. You want to stop changing. Can you? No. So, then there can be, because I'm trying to control this, but I don't know. There can be because the rest of the here because someone thinks that, alas, I had it, alas, I have it no longer, alas, may I have it, alas, I do not do it. Then he sorrows. Grieves, laments. I had it. I don't have it. What does it mean? The person thinks I have an I. Capital I. Now I don't have it. Why doesn't it have it now? Because the Buddha teaches that there is no I. And then you point it, I have heard of it, there is no I. You see? So the, without understanding the Dhamma, he just learns the word superficially and then think, he says that, I had it. I am I. Now he says, I don't have I. So he gets upset. And